Tanta Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Brief History of Everyone Who Ever Lived, a Human Story Retold Through Our Genes, by Adam Rutherford, narrated by Adam Rutherford.
Publisher's note. This audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Brief History of Everyone Who Ever Lived into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the supplemental content section, please enter the access code SPECIES and then click the unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters.
Author's note. Science demands collaboration. There are no lone geniuses, never evil geniuses, and very rarely any heretical geniuses. Almost all science is done by very normal people working in teams or in cahoots with others in similar or dissimilar fields. And they build knowledge on the shoulders of historical and contemporary giants. As Isaac Newton once suggested, parroting the words of the 11th century philosopher Bernard of Chartres, who was referencing the Greek myth of the temporarily blinded hunter Orion, who saw further by sitting a dwarf on his shoulders. The science in this book is perhaps more collaborative than most, as it involves the introduction of a new discipline, genomics, into older ones, namely history, archaeology, paleoanthropology, medicine, and psychology. Author lists of genetics papers can now run into the dozens, hundreds, and occasionally thousands. Long gone are the days when Victorian gentlemen could idle away their inheritances in hot pursuit of the fabric of nature. Many people have helped me with the writing of this book, and I have used numerous research papers. A large number of the studies involve Mark Thomas at University College London, and I'm very grateful for his guidance and friendship over the years. The particular field of ancient DNA is led by a few labs currently, though it is spreading at a feverish pace as the techniques become better and easier to deploy, and as more and more data is accrued. Several of these tales are drawn from the work of Svante Paabo, Turi King and the Richard III Project, Joe Pickrell, David Reich, Josh Aki, Joachim Berger, Graham Koop, Johannes Krauser, and a few others who have all helped me directly or indirectly. The work is theirs, any errors are mine. Introduction. In the distant future, I see open fields for far more important researchers. Light will be thrown on the origin of man and his history. Chapter 14, Recapitulation and Conclusion in the Origin of Species by Charles Darwin, 1859. This is a story about you. It concerns the tale of who you are and how you came to be. It is your individual story because the journey of life that alights at your existence is unique, as it is for every person who has ever drawn breath. And it's also our collective story, because as an ambassador for the whole of our species, you are both typical and exceptional. Despite our differences, all humans are remarkably close relatives, and our family tree is pollarded and tortuous and not in the slightest bit like a tree, but we are the fruit thereof. Something in the order of 107 billion modern humans have existed, though this number depends on when exactly you start counting. All of them, of us, are close cousins, as our species has a single African origin. We don't quite have the language to describe what that really means. It doesn't, for example, mean a single couple, a hypothetical Adam and Eve. We think of families and pedigrees and genealogies and ancestry, and we try to think of the deep past in the same way. Who were my ancestors? You might have a simple, traditional family structure, or, like me, it could be handsomely untidy, its tendrils jumbled like old wires in a drawer. But no matter which, everyone's past becomes muddled sooner or later. We all have two parents, and they had two parents, and all of them had two parents, and so on. Keep going like this all the way back to the last time England was invaded, and you'll see that doubling each generation results in more people than have ever lived by many billions. The truth is that our pedigrees fold in on themselves, the branches loop back and become nets, and all of us who have ever lived have done so enmeshed in a web of ancestry. We only have to go back a few dozen centuries to see that most of the 7 billion of us alive today are descended from a tiny handful of people, the population of a village. History is the stuff that we have recorded. For thousands of years, we have painted, carved, written, and spoken the stories of our pasts and presents in attempts to understand who we are and how we came to be. By consensus, history begins with writing. Before that, we have prehistory, the stuff that happened before we wrote it down. For the sake of perspective, life has existed on Earth for about 3.9 billion years. The species Homo sapiens, of which you are a member, emerged a mere 200,000 years ago in the east of Africa. Writing began about 6,000 years ago in Mesopotamia, somewhere in what we now call the Middle East. For comparison, the book I am now reading is around 111,000 words, or 660,000 characters long, including spaces. If the length of time life has existed on Earth were represented as this book, each character, including spaces, is around 5,909 years. Anatomically, modern humans' tenure on Earth is equivalent to the precise length of this phrase. The time we've been recording history is an evolutionary wing flap equivalent to a single character, the width of a full stop. And how sparse that history is. Documents vanish, dissolve, decompose. They're washed away by the weather or consumed by insects and bacteria, or destroyed, hidden, obfuscated, or revised. That is before we address the subjectivity of the historical record. We can't agree definitively on what happened in the last decade. Newspapers record stories with biases firmly in place. Cameras record images curated by people and only see what passes through the lens, frequently without context. Humans themselves are terribly unreliable witnesses to objective reality. We fumble. The precise details of the events of the 11th of September 2001, when the World Trade Center towers were destroyed, may well remain obscure because of conflicting reports and the chaos of those horrors. Witness testimonies in courts are notoriously defective and are always subject to squint-eyed scrutiny. Flip back a few centuries, and there is no contemporary evidence even for the existence of Jesus Christ, arguably the most influential man in history. Most of our tales about his life were written in the decades after his death by people who never met him. Today, we would seriously question that if it were presented as historical evidence. Even the accounts that Christians rely on, the Gospels, are inconsistent and have been irreversibly mutated over time. This is not to disparage the study of history nor Christianity. It's merely a comment on how the past is foggy. Until recently, it was recorded primarily in religious texts, business transaction documents, and in the papers of royal lineages. In modern times, we have the opposite problem: far too much information and almost no way to curate it. In every purchase you make online, every internet search you do, you volunteer information about yourself to be captured by companies in the ether. Books, sagas, oral histories, inscriptions, archaeology, the internet, databases, film, radio, hard drives, tape. We piece together these bits and bytes of information to reconstruct the past. And now, biology has become part of that formidable swill of information. The epigram I read at the beginning of this introduction is Darwin's single reference to humans in The Origin of Species, right at the end, as if to tease us that there will be a sequel. With his proposed theory of descent with modification in the distant future, light will be shed on our own story, to be continued. Well, that time has come. There is now another way to read our pasts, and floodlights are being shone on our origins. You carry an epic poem in your cells. It's an incomparable, sprawling, unique, meandering saga. About a decade ago, 50 years after the discovery of the double helix, our ability to read DNA had improved to the degree that it was transformed into a historical source, a text to pore over. Our genomes, genes, and DNA house a record of the journey that life on Earth has taken, 4 billion years of error and trial that resulted in you. Your genome is the totality of your DNA, 3 billion letters of it. And due to the way it comes together by the mysterious business of sex, it is unique to you. Not only is this genetic fingerprint yours alone, it's unlike any other of the 107 billion people who have ever lived. That applies even if you are an identical twin whose genomes begin their existence indistinguishable, but inch away from each other moments after conception. In the words of Dr. Seuss, today you are you, that is truer than true. There is no one alive who is youer than you. The sperm that made you started its life in your father's testicles within a few days before your conception. One single sperm out of a spurt of billions ground its head against your mother's egg, one of just a few hundred. Like a Russian doll, that egg had grown in her when she was growing inside her mother. But it matured within the last menstrual cycle and, taking its turn from alternating ovaries, eased its way out of the comfort of its birthplace. On contact, that winning sperm released a chemical that dissolved the egg's reluctant membrane, left its whiplash tail behind, and burrowed in. Once inside, the egg sets an impenetrable fence that stops any others breaching her defences. The sperm was unique, as was the egg. And the combination of the two? Well, that was unique too, and that became you. Even the point of entry was unique, your mother's egg being roughly spherical. That sperm could have punched its way in anywhere. And at the behest of cosmic happenstance, it penetrated its quarry at a single point, a point which set waves of chemicals and effectively began the process of setting your body plan, a head at one end, tail at the other. In other organisms, we know that if the winning sperm had come in on the other side, the embryo that became you would have started growing in a different orientation. And it may well be the same in us. Your parents' genetic material, their genome, had been shuffled in the formation of sperm and egg and halved. Their parents, your grandparents, had provided them with two sets of chromosomes, and the shuffle mixed them up to produce a deck that had never existed before and never will again. They also bestowed upon you just a bit of unshuffled DNA. If you're a man, you have a Y chromosome that was largely unchanged from him and from his father and so on back through time. It's a stunted, shriveled piece of DNA with only a few genes on it and lots of debris. The egg also had some small loops of DNA hiding inside, in its mitochondria, a tiny powerhouse that provides power for all cells. It has its own mini genome, and because it sits inside the egg, this only comes from mothers. Together, these two make up a tiny proportion of your total DNA, but their clear lineages have some use when tracking back through genealogies and ancient history. However, the vast majority of your DNA was forged in the shuffle of your parents and theirs in theirs. That process happened every time a human lived. The chain that precedes you is unbroken. They fuck you up, your mum and dad. They may not mean to, but they do. They fill you with the faults they had and add some extra just for you. I offer no comment on the psychological or parental aspects of Philip Larkin's poem, but from a biological point of view, it's spot on. Each time an egg or sperm is made, the shuffle produces new variation, unique differences in the people that host them. You'll inherit your parents' DNA in unique combinations, and in that process, called meiosis, you will also have invented some brand new genetic variations just for you. Some of these will get passed on if you have children, and they will acquire their own as well. It's upon these differences in populations that evolution can act, and it's in these differences that we can follow the path of humankind as we have roamed across the land and oceans of time into every corner of the planet. Geneticists have suddenly become historians. A single genome contains a huge amount of uncurated data, enough to lay out plans for a human. But genomics is a comparative science. Two sets of DNA from different people contain much more than double that information. All human genomes host the same genes, but they all may be slightly different, which accounts for the fact that we are all incredibly similar and utterly unique. By comparing those differences, we can make inferences about how closely those two people are and when those differences evolved. We can now extend these comparisons to all humanity, as long as we can pull DNA from your cells. When the first complete human genome was published in 2001 to great fanfare, it was in fact a sketchy draft readout of most of the genetic material of just a few of us. To get this far had taken hundreds of scientists the best part of a decade and had cost in the order of $3 billion, approximately $1 per letter of DNA. Just 15 years later, things are emphatically easier, and the amount of data from individual genomes now is incalculable. As I read these words, we have approximately 150,000 fully sequenced human genomes, and useful samplings from literally millions of people from all over the world. Grand medical endeavours with accurate names like the 100,000 Genome Project typify how easily we can now extract the data that we all store in our living cells. Here in the UK, we are seriously considering sequencing genomes of everyone at birth. And it's not limited to the rigour of formal science or governmental medical policy. You can spit in a test tube and get a readout of key parts of your own genome from an armada of companies that will tell you all sorts of things about your characteristics, history, and risk of some diseases for just a couple of hundred quid. We now have the genomes of hundreds of long-dead people too to slot into this grand narrative. The bones of an English king, Richard III, were identified in 2014 with a raft of archaeological evidence, but the deal was royally sealed with his DNA, and that is discussed in Chapter 3. The kings and queens of the past are known to us because of their status, and because history is dominated by telling and retelling their stories. While genetics has enriched the study of monarchs, DNA is the ultimate leveller. And our newfound ability to extract the finest details of the living past has rendered this an examination of people, of countries, of migration, of everyone. We can test and verify or falsify and know the histories of the people, not just the powerful or the celebrities of their day. Nobodies from the past are being elevated to some of the most important people who have ever lived. DNA is universal and, as we'll find out, being in a royal lineage might afford you divine rights over citizens and the spoils that go with inherited power, but evolution, genetics and sex are largely indifferent to nationalities, borders and all that heady power. And we can look further still. The study of ancient humans was once limited to old bones and the ghostly traces of their lives left in dirt. But we can now piece together that genetic information of truly ancient humans, of Neanderthals and other extinct members of our extended family. And these people are revealing a new route to where we are today. We can pluck out their DNA to tell us things that could not be known in any other way. We can, for example, know how a Neanderthal person experienced smell. Retrieved after epochs, DNA has profoundly revised our evolutionary story. The past may be a foreign country, but the maps were inside us the whole time. The amount of data this new science is generating is colossal, phenomenal, and overwhelming. Studies are being published every week that upend what has come before. In the penultimate stages of writing this book, the date of the Great Exodus from Africa shifted more than 10,000 years earlier than previously thought, following the discovery of 47 modern teeth in China. Then, in the final stages, it moved back by another 20,000 years with the detection of Homo sapiens DNA in a millennia-dead Neanderthal girl. These numbers are not much in evolutionary terms, ripples in geological time, but that is much more than the whole of written human history, and so the land continually and dramatically moves under our feet. The first half of this book is about the rewriting of the past using genetics from a time when there were at least four human species on Earth, right up to the kings of Europe into the 18th century. The second half is about who we are today and what the study of DNA in the 21st century says about families, health, psychology, race, and the fate of us. Both parts are drawn from using DNA as a text to sit alongside the historical sources we have relied on for centuries: archaeology, rocks, old bones, legends, chronicles, and family histories. Although the study of ancestors and inheritance is as old as humans, genetics is a scientific field that is young, with a difficult, short history. Human genetics was born as a means of measuring people comparatively, such that the differences between them could be formalized as science and used to justify segregation and subjugation. The birth of genetics is synonymous with the birth of eugenics, though at the time, in the late 19th century, that word did not carry the same toxic meaning that it has now. There are no more controversial subjects in all of science than race. People are different from each other, and the weight of those differences is something that has caused some of the deepest divisions and cruelest, bloodiest acts in history. As we will see, modern genetics has shown how we continue to get the whole concept of race so spectacularly wrong. Humans love telling stories. We're a species that craves narrative, and more specifically, narrative satisfaction, explanation, a way of making sense of things, and the ineffable complexities of being human, beginnings, middles, and ends. When we started to read the genome, what we wanted to find there were narratives that tidied up the mysteries of history and culture and individual identity, that told us exactly who we were and why. Our wishes were not satisfied. The human genome turned out to be far more interesting and complicated than anyone anticipated, and that included all of the geneticists who remain ever more gainfully employed a decade on from the so-called completion of the Human Genome Project. The truth of this complexity and our lack of understanding is struggling to filter down into what we talk about when we talk about genetics. We once spoke of blood and bloodlines as a means of tying us to our ancestors and describing our familial selves. It's no longer in the blood, it's in our genes. DNA has become a byword for destiny or a seam running through us that seals our fates. But it is not. All scientists think that their field is the one that is least well represented in the media. But I'm a scientist and a writer, and I believe that human genetics stands out above all as one destined to be misunderstood. I think because we are culturally programmed to misunderstand it. Science is apt to reveal that much of the world is not how we perceive it, whether that is the cosmological, the molecular, the atomic, or the subatomic. These fields are distant or abstract compared with how we talk about families, about inheritance, about race, about intelligence, and about history. The baggage we carry, the subjectivity with which we naturally approach these quintessentially human characteristics, is without equal. The gap between what science has revealed and how we talk about families and race is a chasm because, as we shall see, things are not how we thought they were. There's plenty of fabrication and myth-making born of DNA as well. Genetics can certainly tell us who our close relatives really are and can reveal so many mysteries of our deep past. But you have far less in common with your ancestors than you may realise. And there are people in your family from whom you have inherited no genes at all, and who therefore have no meaningful genetic link to you, even though in a genealogical sense, you are most definitely descended from them. I will show you that despite what you might have read, genetics won't tell you how smart your kids will be, or what sports they should play, or what gender person they might fancy, or how they will die, or why some people commit acts of heinous violence and murder. Just as important as what genetics can tell us is what it can't. Our DNA is the very thing that has encoded brains so sophisticated enough to be capable of asking questions about our own origins and providing the tools to figure out how evolution has proceeded. Changes in this strange molecule have accumulated and been recorded over time, waiting patiently for millennia for us to discover how to read it. And now we can. Each chapter in this book tells a different story about history and about genetics, of battles lost and won, of invaders, marauders, murder, migration, agriculture, disease, kings, plague, and plenty of deviant sex. Above all, I'm reading a history book. Some of the stories here are the history of genetics, with all its own convoluted twists and dark past, included to understand how we know what we are now discovering. Many of the stories are tales of nations, populations, and a few known through celebrity or inheritance of power, but most are the anonymous multitudes. We can pick through the bones of individual men, women, and children, who through sheer chance died in uncommon circumstances, and turned out to be the people whose lives we would scrutinise forensically, because in the preservation of their death, they inadvertently gave up their DNA to us. Biology is the study of what lives, and therefore what dies. It's messy, wonderfully, frustratingly so, and imprecise, and it defies definitions. If you want to start at the beginning, which might seem like a very good place to start, then here is where our troubles begin. Part 1. How we came to be. Chapter 1. Horny and mobile. There is no beginning, no middle, no end, no suspense, no moral, no causes, no effects. What we love in our books are the depths of many marvellous moments seen all at one time. Kurt Vonnegut, Slaughterhouse-Five. Vonnegut was half right. There is definitely no beginning, and if there is an end, it's not in sight. We are always in the middle, and we are all missing links. Just like there was no absolute point when your life began, there was no moment of creation when our species began. No spark of life, no breath of God into the nostrils of an Adam moulded in the red earth. No cracking of a cosmic egg. So it goes. Nothing living is fixed, and all creatures are four-dimensional, existing in space and also through time. Life is transition. The only things that are truly static are already dead. Your parents had parents, and theirs had parents, and so on, two by two, back through the whole of history and prehistory. If you keep going back and back, your ancestors will slowly and inevitably become unrecognisable to you via apes and monkeys, two-legged, then quadrupedal, and ratty mammals and brutish beasts on land, and before them in wading sea creatures and fishy swimmers and worms and weedy sea plants. And around 2 billion years ago, you don't even need two parents, but just the binary fission of a single cell. One becomes two. Eventually, at the beginning of life on Earth, around 4 billion years ago, you're locked in a rock at the bottom of the oceans, inside the hot, bubbling tumult of a hydrothermal vent. This geologically slow, incremental change is like a colour chart, where, pixel by pixel, white becomes black, whether it's the gap from reptile to mammal or from four-legged to upright. On occasion, there'll be a splash of colour thrown into the mix, but for the most part, the pathway to your ancestors creeps rather than jerks, and all of it grey in its depths. Creeps or jerks was a joke formulated by the great biologists Stephen Jay Gould and John Turner concerning the arguments about whether evolution proceeded continuously or with catastrophic game-changing disruption. These two ideas, more formally known as phyletic gradualism and punctuated equilibrium, competed for years. The answer, as so often is the case in science, is broadly a bit of both. Life on Earth has been continuous in that time. We are a dot on that grey continuum. Conjure up that image of a hairy monkey-like ape on all fours, to the left of a crouching ape, to the left of a hunched, stooping ape, to the left of an upright, modern, bearded man-ape, like us, wielding a flint-tipped spear with his right leg cocked coyly forward to protect us from seeing his immodest instruments of biological transition. This iconic image implies something that we now know is untrue. We just don't know the pathway of the apes that led to us. We know many of the creatures en route, but the map is full of gaps and smears. The second untruth is the suggestion that there is direction to our evolution, to our bipedal gait and our big, beefy brains and our tools and culture. With that arrow, we are to infer progress from simplicity to an inescapable advance into the erect future, an inevitable cognitive revolution of the mind. Alas, we are no more or less evolved than any creature. Uniqueness is terribly overrated. We're only as unique as every other species, each uniquely evolved to extract the best possible hope for our genes to be passed on into infinity, given the present unique circumstances. With all the bones of evolution and a modern understanding of evolution and genetics, it's impossible to conceive of a 20-step progress of apes from the left to the right, let alone those neat, discrete jumps in five moves. There is no measure of the progress of evolution, and the language we once used, where species were higher or lower, no longer carries any meaning for science. Charles Darwin used those words, as was the style of his time, when he outlined the mechanism for the origin of species in 1859. Though he did write in the margin of one of his notebooks, never say higher or lower, more as an expression of caution for the idea of evolutionary progress. He noted that some barnacles became simpler in chronological evolution. Darwin did love a barnacle. We had scant evidence for other upright apes back then, with or without their spears. He had no mechanism for how that modification was passed from generation to generation. Since the end of the 19th century, we've known the patterns by which characteristics are passed from parent to child. In the 1940s, we discovered that DNA was the molecule that transmitted the information down the generations. Since 1953, we've known that the double helix is how DNA is built, giving it its impressive ability to copy itself and allow those copies to build cells just like the ones they came from. And since the 1960s, we've known of how DNA encodes proteins, and that all life is built of or by proteins. Those titans of science, Gregor Mendel, Francis Crick, James Watson, Rosalind Franklin, and Maurice Wilkins, stood on their predecessors and colleagues' shoulders and would in turn be the giants from whose shoulders all biologists would see into the future. The unravelling of these mysteries were the great science stories of the 20th century, and by the beginning of the 21st, the principles of biology were set in place. In cracking the universal genetic code and unwinding the double helix, we had unveiled a set of simple rules of life. Yet they turned out to be profoundly complex, as we shall soon see. But Darwin didn't know any of that. When he published his second great work, The Descent of Man, in 1871, his primary concern was the question of whether man, like every other species, is descended from some pre-existing form. Then, just a handful of Neanderthal remains were known, a skull from Belgium, another from Gibraltar, and a bag of bones from central Germany. As early as 1837, Darwin had sketched out a visionary version of an evolutionary tree in a notebook, showing how one branch of life became two and more, selected by nature in response to the changing environment. How these ancient apes fitted into the human tree was entirely unknown. "I think," he scrawled at the top of the page of that notebook, in his inimitably dreadful handwriting. But he never finished that thought. What was set in motion in the 19th century was the idea that, alongside all animals, we were part of a continuum, a species begotten, not created. Nowadays, only the willfully ignorant dismiss the truth that we are evolved from earlier ancestors. The images of giggle mug skulls of our long-dead forebears are commonplace, and they become front-page news when a new species is claimed. Dozens of lines of evidence bellow incontrovertibly that we are an ape, with an ape ancestor common to chimpanzees, bonobos, gorillas, and orangutans. Sometimes people say, as a way of revealing the paucity of the fossil record, that all the specimens of ancient human evolution could be placed on a large table or in a single coffin. Well, that's not true either. We have literally thousands of ancient hardened bones found all around the world. Many in the nursery of the human story in Eastern Africa, many in Europe, and the more we look, the more we find. For Darwin, though, we were effectively alone at the end of a mysterious branch on our family tree. But for all the sheer grit of the diggers who devote their lives to sitting in dugout caves or dusty ancient riverbeds, armed with toothbrushes and tiny picks, there are not nearly enough physical specimens to reveal anything resembling a complete picture and the progress of humans. There are individual fossils arranged into groups according to shared characteristics, such as the shapes of their brows, the arch of an instep, the cusps on their molars. These are dated according to where they were found, in which layer in the ground, and what other things were found nearby: tools, the shadows of cooking or traces of hunting. Or, if they're young enough, by the ratio of radioactive carbon atoms, which, instead of being replenished via living metabolism, in death are slowly ticking down at a regular rate. This is all good, robust science, contentious as research often is, and frequently fractious. But the analysis of old bones is precise, complex, and highly sophisticated. In the 200 years since the first other human species was discovered, our understanding of how we came to be has undoubtedly increased immeasurably. But our confidence in that path has changed and continues to evolve. For decades, that image of the progress of monkey ape to ape man to man ape has been on display in museums around the world and in textbooks, a nice line of clear evolution that says, this is how we got here. In Down House in the English county of Kent, where Darwin beetled away, meticulously drawing up the best idea that anyone ever had, you can still buy coffee mugs with that image on it. When I was young and falling in love with science in the 1980s, the evolutionary trees looked just like that. My father would collect articles for me from New Scientist or Scientific American, showing neat branching diagrams, suggesting that one species morphed into another, or one becoming two, with the other gruff ape men perishing along the way. The picture seemed clearer the fewer specimens we had. By the end of the 20th century, more and more human species and specimens had risen from their graves, different enough to blur those nice clean lines, and the branches got fatter, less distinct, and more pollarded. Maybe it's time for us to retire the long-serving metaphor of the evolutionary tree of life, and certainly the picture of apes to ape men to man apes. Today, you'd be hard-pushed to call it a bush, shrub, or anything arboreal at all. Instead, it's represented in graphical form as more of a set of upside-down, dribbly blobs running upwards into the pool that is us. Streams, rivers, and rivulets, some running into the ocean, others petering out en route. And you can see this in Figure 1 in the accompanying PDF. An alternative version is to place the specimens in their species clusters on a chart, oldest at the bottom, us, the sole survivors, at the top, the width showing the geography of where all the bones were found. And you must accept that the lines between them are dotted, meaning hypothetical. If this was a detective story, we have the bodies, but the clues are scant and disconnected. The case is far from settled. We're utterly fascinated with ourselves, and with some justification. We are just another animal, but we're the only one evolved to have scrutinised our own existence, to look in the mirror and really squint at it. Many, many books have been written about the origin of our species, but this story deals specifically with just those from which we can reconstruct the past and past relationships using the newest tool in the paleoanthropologist's shed, and that is DNA. That molecule has revolutionised much of our understanding of human history in unprecedented ways, all in the space of a couple of decades at the beginning of this century. It's a field changing so rapidly that researchers have told me of their reluctance to publish new findings for fear of them being superseded, not within years or months, but within weeks or even days. Keeping track is not an easy task, as the study of human evolution is mutating into an unremitting revolution. The picture of how we humans came to be what we are is more detailed than ever before, and we still have a long way to go. Before we get to all of that, here is a brief, scant overview of the story so far. Let us begin not at the beginning, because there was no beginning, but somewhat arbitrarily with 2 feet. Bipedal apes walked the Earth at least 4 million years ago. In fact, all apes are capable of two-footed movement, but what concerns us is habitual bipedalism, walking as a primary means of travel. Standing upright was a quintessential step in our own evolution, as it prompted and coincided with a number of anatomical changes, such as the position and shape of the spine, how it connects to the skull, and so on. Why this happened is not agreed upon, and there are plenty of theories. Some focus on an increased efficiency of movement in being upright, others on its being an adaptation to suit life on the savannah rather than swinging in the trees or the changing climate of the Rift Valley. The most famous of these early walkers is Lucy, born around 3.2 million years ago. 40% of her fossilised skeleton, which is a lot to be preserved for remains that old, was discovered in 1974 by Donald Johansson and named after the Beatles song Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds that was playing back at the researchers' base camp in the Awash Valley in Ethiopia that heady night. Lucy was one of the first members of the species Australopithecus afarensis to be discovered. We cannot say whether her species was a direct ancestor of us. What we can say is that there were many other primates living at this time, and she looks more closely related to us than any other. The classification of animals is also a frequently unsatisfactory business, but to tell the story of our species, we need to dive in and hope for the best. The system that we exclusively use was invented in the 18th century by the Swedish naturalist Carl Linnaeus and gives creatures two Latin names, a genus and a species. The ranks genus and species are the last and thus most specific of the hierarchies of classification or taxonomy. The standard ranking is kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, and species. I was taught this with the memorable, if not kind, mnemonic, kings play cards on fat girls' stomachs, though there are plenty of other versions. King Philip came over for group sex may suit your fancies better. An English oak tree is a Quercus robur. There's a wasp called Lalapa loser, and a Fijian snail called Bar humbugi. Enema pan is the rhinoceros beetle. The common toad is Buffo buffo, which might seem a bit lazy as it's Latin for toad, but lots of common animals have this form, including the mollusk extra extra and our fellow great apes, gorilla gorilla. There is officially a category below species, subspecies, in which different types within a species can be separated. Gorilla is the genus, and there are species within that genus. Gorilla beringii, informally named the eastern gorilla, has the dubious honour of being named after Friedrich Robert von Beringe, the first person to shoot one. The western gorilla, Gorilla gorilla, is the most abundant species, but there are also two subspecies of these, one of which is the western lowland gorilla. Gorilla 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 is its scientific name. It is okay to find this amusing, though taxonomists are deadly serious people. Lucy's type, Australopithecus afarensis, roughly translates as southern ape-like thing from afar. And there are other species of southern ape-like things, Sediba, Anamensis, and Africanus. Earlier apes are slotted into genus categories with names like Sivapithecus, which translates as Shiva's ape, having been found in India, and Ardipithecus, which translates as ground ape, and Gigantopithecus, which is a really big ape. We are genus, homo, species, sapiens, homo sapiens, the wise man. That's the short version. There's an equivalent in biology to when children write their addresses from street to town to country to continent, hemisphere, solar system, and galaxy. Several classification ranks sit above genus and species to place us precisely in the living universe. Domain, eukaryota, complex life. Kingdom, animalia, animals. Phylum, chordate, animals with a central column akin to a backbone. Class, mammalia, milk producing. Order, primates, monkeys, apes, tarsiers, and a few more. Suborder, haplorini, dry-nosed apes. Family, hominidae, great apes. Everything in this book from here on in will be Homo. Neanderthals are classified as Homo neanderthalensis, the humans from the Neander Valley in Germany. Homo habilis, the handyman. You belong to a strangely exclusive club. Membership of a genus doesn't necessarily show relatedness between the members, but instead shows that members are more similar to each other than they are to organisms not in that genus. This is the best system we have. Species is a definition also riven with problems, but the most acceptable form is that two species are defined as distinct when they are incapable of producing fertile offspring together. Zebroids, ligers, mules, hinnies, growler bears, all relatively rare, relatively healthy hybrids. A zebroid is a zebra with any other equine animal. A liger is a male lion with a lady tiger. A mule is a jack donkey with a female horse. A hinny is a jenny donkey with a male horse. And a growler bear is a polar bear with a grizzly. Very rare, but presumably utterly terrifying. None of these hybrids produce fertile offspring of their own. Soon, we shall see why this species definition for humans is not at all adequate. The current convention is to list around 7 species that fit into the genus Homo. And I will be referring to them as human. This is not uncontroversial, but one of the key problems of taxonomy is that in trying to name things, we are attempting to describe how things are. And this doesn't necessarily acknowledge the essential temporal nature of life, that evolution is universal and that change over time is the norm. Remember that the subject of evolutionary change is DNA, but classification does not depend on that. For the time being, though, let us think of species as distinct groups of animals who are different enough to be incapable of producing fertile offspring together. And in the genus Homo, there have been about 7. Ones for whom we have fossil remains from the period starting a million years ago can be called archaic humans, and there are a few. Homo ergaster, heidelbergensis, antecessor, and a few more, all present in different places and with subtly different anatomical details during this period, and they are all thought to evolve from earlier Homo erectus, the upright human. They did an excellent job of populating the world, but we don't believe so far that they have left any DNA for us to recover, and here we are tracking the past with DNA. Most of the others have also not yielded any DNA samples yet, probably because they're too old, or died in places too hot for it to endure, and so our understanding of our relationship to them is limited to fossils and paleoarchaeology. The ground of human evolution trembled with the discovery of a tiny woman on the Indonesian island of Flores in 2005. The skeletal remains of a metre-high female, with parts of at least 8 other people, were unearthed in a cave called Liang Bua. Immediately, these miniature humans, classified as Homo floresiensis, were referred to as hobbits, and though their feet are large, there was no evidence of them being hairy. They appear to have lived in this humid cave as recently as 13,000 years ago, which is only a few centuries before the beginning of farming. These tiny people cooked with fire and probably butchered meat of giant rats and stegodons, a species of tiny elephant that lived alongside them. Who were these small humans? The initial reports in the journal Nature were clear that their bodies were similar enough to be included in the genus Homo, but different enough to warrant being a separate species from any other known Homo. A vocal minority of scientists criticised this position and asserted that they were actually like us, but diseased and shrunken through some speculative pathology. Down syndrome, microcephaly, Laron syndrome, and endemic cretinism have all been suggested, but the evidence for these is slight and dicey. Populations on islands often evolve to be very big or very small, as the forces of selection might be limited and specific to insular isolation. And indeed, the hobbits shared their islands with rodents of unusual size, tiny hippos, and dwarf elephants. All are now extinct, but it seems most likely that Homo floresiensis was a separate species of human, probably sharing a common ancestor with us at some point within the last 2 million years, but had shrunk in size due to the pressures of a tropical island life. A brief word here about cryptids, proposed, mythological, or vaguely reported species that remain elusive, theoretical, or alien to science. For centuries, there have been myths and legends about extant human-like contemporaries of ours. Ape men, yetis in the Himalayas, Sasquatch in Canada, Barmanau in Southeast Asia, Manananggal of the Philippines, the Australian Yowie and Bigfoot and many others in the rural United States. None of these has ever come close to verification in a way that would slake a scientist's thirst, including such things as evidence of bodies, fossils, hunting or feeding behaviour, or even a decent photo, which you might find surprising in a world with literally billions of cameras and now camera phones, and an industry dedicated to finding these elusive monkey men. When DNA began to become a useful tool in the identification and classification of animals in the 1990s, some studies emerged, and continue to do so to this day, that claim to prove the existence of one of these cryptid ape men. So far, all of them have been rejected outright by scientists, with a mixture of derision and, in recent high-profile media courting claims in the UK, weariness. There is the legend of an ape man on the island of Flores called Ebugogo, short and hairy, the females with long, pendulous breasts. It is tempting to link the very real remains of the long-extinct Homo floresiensis with these legends, but it is far more likely that Ebugogo is simply a local version of the myth of Orang Pendek, a short-statured cryptid story that is common around Sumatra and other islands. Cryptozoology lumbers onwards on the fringes of science and value. But back to the Hobbit. We couldn't get DNA out of the remains of these midgets. The bones were not fossilised and were soft like wet cardboard. An attempt to extract DNA was made in 2009 using a tooth, which is hard on the outside, and so offers some protection from the ages. It failed, and their DNA is lost in time, like tears in rain. Maybe the heat and humidity of the tropics over a few millennia was enough to annihilate all of the DNA that might have been skulking in those teeth and decaying bones. It's a shame that this is the case, as there have been heated arguments about the provenance of these people. And DNA would have solved them in a heartbeat. Their island status, the position and limitations of their range, and their physical characteristics suggest that the Hobbits of Flores were not ancestors of ours, but distant cousins. Nevertheless, the number of human species who lived into the past 50,000 years had suddenly gone from 2 to 3, and deservedly, the Hobbit and its freakish giant and dwarf island cohabitants were famous. Overnight, our planet had started to look a bit more like Middle Earth. Learning to read. And it was going to get more like Middle Earth as DNA reading technology matured. For more than 100 years, the study of human evolution had been dominated by bones and a few tools, anatomy and culture. Reading DNA is really a form of anatomy on a molecular scale. It contains clues to how bones are shaped and how evolution has shaped them. The invention of the technology to read DNA was primarily born of a desire to understand disease, but it was clear that decoding genomes would illuminate human history too. Here is a short interlude about how we learnt to read DNA. In 1997, in the world of living human genetics, the largest scientific project in history was going full steam ahead. Hundreds of scientists, some former competitors, had effectively teamed up with a common goal: to provide the world with a complete readout of every single letter of DNA in a human being, all 3 billion of them. The tale of the Human Genome Project is told in Chapter 5, but for this story, the most important thing is that this was a technological grand scheme designed to make reading the letters of DNA easy and cheap. In doing so, medicine, evolution, and the mysteries of being human would be revolutionised. The ability to read DNA was pioneered by the unassuming English genius Fred Sanger in the late 1970s, using a process that copied the original sequence millions of times. To do that, your ingredients need to include the alphabet you're writing in. DNA only consists of 4 letters, more formally called nucleotide bases, A, T, C, and G. You also need an enzyme whose job it is to simply copy and link up the bases of DNA, called a polymerase. Throw all of these ingredients into a tube and set the temperature right, and the double helix will separate into single strands, which serve as templates to replace the letters that would form the missing strand. You end up with millions of copies of the original template. Each one of the letters of DNA physically links to the one that precedes it and the one that follows, whereas English full stops halt any sentence. The polymerase molecule trundles along, adding the next letter one at a time, like a typewriter copying a line of text. In DNA sequencing, you add not just the correct letter molecules, but also a few that act as full stops. Because so many copies are made during this process, And because the full stops are added randomly, what you end up with is a swill of DNA molecules that stop at every single letter. Sequencing DNA is reconstruction. You make millions of copies that are fragmented at every letter. You then order them by size. DNA is a molecule that carries a negative electrical charge, and this means that if you stick it in some salty water and put a voltage across that water, the DNA will head towards the positive electrode. The speed at which it migrates is determined by its mass, which is determined by how long that fragment is. A large piece will move slower than a small one. So, if instead of putting it in water, you put the DNA in a jelly-like gel to slow it down and run an electrical charge across the gel, then the DNA will separate very precisely according to size, just like sieving dirt. There's one more trick to this technique. There are only four letters of DNA, unlike the English alphabet's cumbersome 26. So, take your original gene and separate it into four tubes. In each of the tubes, you add all of the ingredients, but in the first you also add A bases that halt the chain, ones that add the full stop, but only when there is an A on the template. In the second, you include everything as well as chain-terminating C bases, and so on in tubes 3 and 4, T's and G's. After the reactions are complete, you have one tube which contains every fragment of DNA that ends with an A, in the second that ends with a C, the third with a T, and the fourth with a G. If you stick these four solutions in four columns on a gel and then apply the current, they'll be drawn out and separated, and every position of every letter will be revealed. Your A column will read like this. Blank, 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 A, A. And the T column, blank, blank, T, blank, T, blank, blank. The C column, C, blank, blank, C, blank, 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 and G, blank, G, blank, 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 blank. If you overlay these four together, the blanks become letters and you get a complete read. C, G, T, C, T, A, A. When you see TV scientists holding up X-ray sheets covered in dotted black lines in neat columns, that is what they're looking at. It's a sequence of the letters of DNA that sit inside a cell in your body, unreadable for 4 billion years, but now rendered so commonplace that it can be done in minutes for a few quid. It's an incredibly clever way of reading DNA, and Fred Sanger quite rightly picked up his second Nobel Prize for Chemistry for inventing it. The first, in 1958, was for determining the amino acid sequence of the insulin protein. Sanger is the only person to have won the chemistry gong twice, and one of only four to have won two Nobels in any category. He died during the writing of this book, but he will be well remembered in his techniques and in the Wellcome Trust Sanger Institute outside Cambridge, close to where he lived. It is one of the great centres of genome research in the world. During the 1990s, with the Human Genome Project's aims being to sequence 3 billion letters, Sanger's technique was evolved, improved, and automated. There is an account in Chapter 5 as to why this was still a gargantuan task that took years and billions of dollars to complete. When I was a student in the 1990s, I would send off purified samples of short lengths of DNA to a specialist sequencing department and wait for a few days for the results, not on nicely photogenic X-rays, but in computer files. Now, most genetics labs have their own sequencers, and they churn out megabytes of data in hours. New techniques have been invented that have not completely replaced Sanger sequencing, but are even quicker and cheaper. And were you to begin a career as a geneticist today, you would probably never employ this technique. We even have sequences smaller than a deck of cards that will plug directly into your laptop via a USB port, and so can be taken out into the field to sequence the genomes of animals and plants in the wild. All these technologies are fueling the revolution in genetics for everyone alive. Since the turn of the century, we've been able to do the same for people who have been deceased for quite some time. And death shall have no dominion. In a hole in the ground, a man lay extremely dead. He was either left in this tomb by his family or perished right there, with no idea that he was one of the more important people in millions of years. Posthumously, very posthumously, this man did two things. The first is that his emergence out of that cave kick-started the study of ancient humans. It had been his home, we presume, in what we now call Germany, around 40,000 years ago. Kleine Feldhofer Grotte is no longer there. It was discovered but destroyed by quarry miners in the 19th century. The entrance stood a few metres off the ground, a man-sized squeeze into a rocky room about 3 by 5 metres with a high ceiling. Of the things pulled out by amateur sleuths in the 1850s, and subsequently in excavations of the buried site this century, thousands of artefacts have been found, and the remains of at least 3 people. Fossilised bones were found by the quarry miners in 1856, a drinks coaster-sized chunk of skull, 2 femurs, more arm bones than one person requires, and fragments of a shoulder blade and ribs. The miners handed these bones over to a local anthropologist. The remains of this man were not the first. He was probably the 3rd non-Homo sapiens human skeleton to have been discovered. But he became what is known as the type specimen, the one that defines the species, against which all are subsequently compared. The name of the species is formally attached to the type specimen. So, whatever his name was in life, as far as we are concerned, he became known as Neanderthal 1. With the formal identification of this man, the field of paleoanthropology, the study of ancient humans, truly began. But they wouldn't let him lie. The second revolutionary thing that Neanderthal 1 did occurred another 150 years later. He volunteered his DNA. Up in that cold cave, his remains were protected, to a degree, from the elements, from hungry animals, and most significantly, from voracious bacteria, all of which would happily eventually destroy all the evidence that he had once lived. Instead, due to his unusual domicile, his bones were left as untouched as someone lying dead for 40,000 years can be, and that meant that he became the first non-Homo sapiens human to enter what was, in 1997, a very exclusive club. Tucked inside the slowly decaying cells of what was probably his throwing arm were the molecules that faithfully carry ancestry from the past into the future. We modern humans weren't the only ones in the Human Genome Project. Somewhat counterintuitively, there were 6 species included in the project's primary aims. A genome is much more useful if it can be compared to another, and that includes genomes from other species. So, the original mission of the first creatures to join the genome club aside from us included the most commonly used model organisms, the fly, Drosophila melanogaster, the rat, the mouse, our closest ape relative, the chimp, and an oddity, the honeybee, for it is a social beast, and almost all members don't get to reproduce at all, but serve their queen with whom they share exactly half their DNA. All of these were due to have their entire genomes read, deciphered, and interrogated over the cusp of the 20th century. In 1997, using precisely the same techniques being developed for living humans, a Swedish researcher working in Leipzig quietly laid the foundation stones for a new, utterly revolutionary field, paleogenetics. Svante Paabo had borrowed the right humerus, the bone between the elbow and the shoulder, of Neanderthal 1 from Rheinische Landesmuseum Bonn. With a precision saw, he sliced an inch-long segment out of the middle, exposing what was once soft, vibrant marrow where blood and immune cells would have been thriving. Bone marrow is the site of a panoply of new cell generation, and that means they are dividing energetically, which means replicating their genetic material boisterously. There lay the first treasure trove of Neanderthal DNA. DNA is universal in all living species. It's packaged up in different ways, a language organised into books, chapters, origami, and pamphlets, and passed around the generations in different ways too. In animals, DNA is bundled up into chromosomes, huge chunks of double helix, wrapped around itself and wrapped around tiny lumpy proteins, which again spiral tight together until they look like those iconic X shapes that we see in textbooks. In most cells, we carry 2 complete sets of chromosomes, one set inherited from your mother, one from your father, 23 pairs in total, all neatly stored in the nucleus, the little nut in the centre of cells. Biology is a science of exceptions and endless qualifications, and 22 of those pairs are the same as each other, called autosomes, and one of those pairs is not a pair. The pair that is not a pair are the sex chromosomes. I have a Y and an X, whereas women have two X's. Women get one X from each parent, but men only get their Y chromosome from their fathers. But, though the Y is important for determining maleness, it's a weedy piece of DNA compared to the others, and makes up very little of the total amount of DNA. The X is the second biggest of all the human chromosomes. There's another exception to the way DNA is passed from parent to child. All the autosomes and the sex chromosomes never leave the nucleus, a bound space in the centre of most cells. But there's a minuscule but terribly important bit of DNA that is not in the nucleus, but instead sits inside the mitochondria, the tiny but powerful energy generation units that all complex life relies on. They were almost certainly acquired around 2 billion years ago when two single-celled organisms fused for mutual benefit. What that meant was that these new cells formed a new branch of life, the eukaryotes, different from everything that had come before, which were small, single-celled beings, either bacteria or archaea. These three groups are called domains, and they're at the very top of the hierarchy of living things, above the five kingdoms. The three domains are bacteria, archaea, and eukaryota, which is basically everything that is not in the first two categories. The eukaryotes carry inside them a tiny amount of very important DNA that is not stored in the nucleus, but bound inside these subcellular power stations. In contrast to the scraggy Y chromosome, mitochondrial DNA is only passed from mother to child. The sperm swims along with only half the genetic information to make a new person, 22 chromosomes and an X if that child is to be a woman or a Y. And it wheedles its way into the egg, which also carries 22 chromosomes and an X, and also the mitochondrial DNA of the mother. Almost all, more than 97% of your DNA is carried in the 22 pairs of autosomes and the X. And all this genetic information is inherited from both parents in a roughly equal manner. Each of the autosomes is a unique combination of the pairs of chromosomes that your mother or father inherited from their mother and father. When a sperm or egg is being forged in your father's testes or in the ovaries of your mother, the two matching chromosomes line up and shuffle. Imagine lining up two suits of cards, hearts and clubs, in a row, and then swapping some of the same numbers with each other. The result would be two complete suits, all the right numbers in the right order, but a mix of hearts and clubs. This is what the chromosomes do in making sex cells. But instead of ace to king, each chromosome has millions of possible swaps. So the result is, for each of the 22 autosomes, a new combination. It is this process called recombination that guarantees that your precise genetic makeup is unique to you for all time. Mitochondria and the Y don't do this. One comes from your mother, which came from her mother and from her mother and all the way back only on your maternal side. And the Y exactly the same on your paternal side. For those in pursuit of ancestry, these make for interesting tools and ones that have been the focus of many studies, not least because they've been historically the easiest, smallest, and therefore the first chunks of DNA available for ancestral scrutiny. Mitochondria exist in their millions in the busy milieu inside cells, and so the chances of their surviving the onslaught of time is higher. The autosomes and sex chromosomes exist as one complete set, kept exclusively inside the nucleus, the cell's central office. So, compared to the nuclear DNA, there is stacks of it, millions of identical copies, all much more readily available for analysis. Both mitochondrial DNA and the Y chromosome will make frequent appearances in these pages, not just because they're informative, but also because their value is sometimes overstated in the hunt for ancestry. The Neanderthals were a people who lived all over Western Europe, from the easternmost tip of Spain to the caves of North Wales, into the mountains of Central Asia, and as far south as Israel. The oldest true Neanderthal bones we found are 300,000 years old, and we've not discovered any younger than 30,000. That is a reasonable longevity for a human species. Homo erectus, an earlier upright ape, spread all over the world from an exodus out of Africa that began 1.9 million years ago. But the Neanderthals still clocked up a longer innings than we have so far. We anatomically modern humans are generally thought to have evolved in eastern Africa around 200,000 years ago and emerged out of Africa in our own exodus sometime in the last 100,000 years. This number inches up every few years as more specimens are found. A discovery in October 2015 from the Fuyan Cave in the Daozhan region in southern China dug up 47 modern teeth at least 80,000 years old. And it's not unreasonable to presume that the owners of those teeth took some tens of thousands of years to get that far east from the motherland. According to traditional paleoanthropology, based on bones, by the time Homo sapiens reached Europe, probably around 60,000 years ago, the Neanderthals were already there and well established, albeit in small communities. But with DNA as evidence, these dates are due for serious revision, as we shall see later in this chapter. Nevertheless, their anatomy says clearly that Neanderthals were visibly different from the interlopers. Brain capacity is one of the key measures in paleoanthropology, and the Neanderthals had bigger ones than us. A modern man's averages at about 1.4 litres by volume, women's being a little smaller. The Neanderthals range between 1.5 and 1.9 litres. That cranial capacity is not something we can specifically correlate with intellectual capabilities, though in general, in apes, bigger brains mean more sophistication. They were shorter and stockier than us, thicker set, barrel-chested, with broader noses and clunkier brows. It's surely for these simple physical reasons that they have a pretty bad reputation. In common parlance, they're synonymous with and stigmatised as brutish cavemen, grunting oafs. And Neanderthal acts as a byword for low-brow, dim-wit thuggery. When the classification of the early specimens was being wrangled in the 19th century, the great German biologist Ernst Haeckel suggested one specimen be known as Homo stupidus. Nothing indicates that the Neanderthals were anything of the sort, nor significantly different from their Homo sapiens contemporaries. They hunted, butchered, and cooked large prey. In the last 100,000 years, there is some evidence that they sewed, made clothes and jewellery. And these tools predate the arrival of anatomically modern humans, meaning that the Neanderthals developed these skills themselves, rather than learning them from the new kids on the block. Recently, researchers have claimed that hand paintings in a cave in Nerja on the pebbly Mediterranean coast of Spain were theirs and not ours. Some have argued that the presence of pollen in graves in Shanidar in Iraq and in southern France were traces from flowers left there as part of ritual burials, though this remains controversial. The bones discovered in that French cave in La Chapelle aux Saints in 1908 were the ones that gave rise to the stereotype of a hunched caveman oaf. In the 1980s, much more forensic analysis by Eric Trinkhaus showed that this was a 40-year-old man hunched because of osteoarthritis, not because that's how they all stood. Because of the paucity of remains, the evolutionary relationship between Homo neanderthalensis and Homo sapiens has long been disputed. The full gamut of suggestions has been made over the years, from their being the direct ancestors of modern Europeans to their existence on a completely different bough of the evolutionary tree, who left no extant descendants. The last common ancestor of us and them is thought to have existed around 600,000 years before today. Svante Paabo's digging within Neanderthal 1's arm bone was the first step in answering this. They extracted 0.4 grams of matter, the weight of a decent pinch of salt, from the section of precision butchered bone, and from it pulled fragments of mitochondrial DNA. This was, in 1997, the most ancient DNA yet recovered. Much of that first study was devoted to showing that it was possible, and that DNA...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.